Good morning. How are all of y'all today? Great. Pardon our dust this morning from our rummage sale, but they were able to make about $5,000, over $5,000 on the rummage sale. So we're very pleased with that. And if you got to walk through here while they were doing it, your sinuses and coughing and everything, it was a phenomenal thing with that. But we're glad that you're all here today. We pray that God's going to bless and touch you today. And we're excited about Palm Sunday, where when Jesus came into Jerusalem, the people waved their palm branches and shouted Hosanna to the King. And hopefully all of y'all got a palm for yourself today. And we'll be having a special part with that. But let's open with a word of prayer. Gracious and loving God, we come today and shout Hosanna. Save us all, Lord Jesus. Come into this place and save our hearts. Touch our souls. Touch our minds. Help us to feel the love that you have for us. And help us not to make mistakes over and over and over again, just like the Israelites did. But help us to overcome our worries, our doubts, our fears, our sins, and empower us through your Holy Spirit to be the people you are calling us to be. Help us to worship and praise you with all that we have this morning, and help us to know that Jesus is King and saves us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, stand if you're able, and we'll begin with praise and worship.
Palm Sunday was a happy day, so we're going to sing the happy song, right?
Oh, I could sing unending songs of how you saved my soul. And I could dance a thousand miles because of your great love. My heart is bursting, Lord, to tell of all you've done and how you changed my life and wiped away the past. I want to shout it out from every rooftop, sing. I know that God is for me, not against me. If I could sing unending songs of how you saved my soul. Oh, I could dance a thousand miles because of your great love. My heart is bursting, Lord, to tell of all you've done and how you changed my life and wiped away the past. I want to shout it out from every rooftop, sing. I know that God is for me, not against me. If I could sing unending songs, how you saved my soul. Oh, if I could dance a thousand miles because of your great love. My heart is bursting, Lord, tell of all you've done and how you changed my life and wiped away the past. Now I want to shout it out from every rooftop, sing. I know that God is for me, not against me. Everybody's singing now, because we're so happy. Oh, everybody's dancing now, cause we're so happy. Oh, if only we could see your face and see it smiling over us. Unseen angels celebrate. The joy is in this place. Oh, 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 oh. Let me hear you. Oh, if I could sing unending songs of how you saved my soul. Oh, I could dance a thousand miles because of your great love.
One more time.
Oh, I could sing unending songs of how you saved my soul. Oh, I could dance a thousand miles because of your great love. Whoa.
Outstanding. If that didn't make you happy, I don't know what it is. We'll have the children's sermon over here on these couches if y'all go over there for our children's moment. How many of y'all are happy now after singing that? All right.
Good morning. How are y'all today? All right, I'm sure y'all all know what this is. Have any of y'all ever gotten to wear this at school? You've never gotten to wear one at school? Oh, my students get to wear them when like, it's their birthday or something, and they get to have a special day. Y'all know, y'all don't wear these at school? Do y'all ever get like a little, oh, you have a different one? Do y'all get like a little badge on your birthday that says happy birthday, and you kind of get special privileges that day? Yeah, so you get to, maybe you're the line leader for the day, or you get to be the teacher's special helper. Yeah, or you just take turns getting to be the student helper. This says the student of the day. Do y'all get to be the student of the day sometimes? Yeah. In the city of Jerusalem, about 2,000 years ago, a king was visiting the city. People lined the streets hoping to see the king. When the king entered the city, riding on a small donkey, the people spread their cloaks on the road, and others waved palm branches and shouted, "Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed, Hosanna in the highest heaven." Who was the king? Y'all know who the king was? Jesus, yeah. Today we remember the entry of Jesus into Jerusalem and the people cheering and waving the palm branches. That's why we just sang the song and we waved our palm branches around, right? Yeah. They greeted Jesus as their king, but the only problem was it didn't last. He only got to be the king for one day. So just like you only get to be student of the day, he only got to be the king for one day. Later that same week, Jesus was arrested, beaten, tried, and crucified. Many of the same people who cheered him on Sunday had turned against him. Now he wore a crown, but it was a crown of thorns. The Bible tells us that one day every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Why wait? Why not confess that Jesus is Lord today? Jesus wants to be the ruler and the Lord of your life. He doesn't want to be just your king for just one day. He wants to be your king for all of the days, right? For your forever king. All right, y'all want to say a prayer? All right. Dear God, we are sometimes quick to say, Jesus is Lord, but slow to show it in our lives. Help us be faithful followers. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Say slow to show seven times really fast. That was a difficult one, wasn't it? And we're going to be reading from Judges chapter 2, verses 6 through 19. Judges chapter 2, 6 through 19. I might have to read from that screen. My eyes are kind of dark this morning. After Joshua sent the people away, each of the tribes left to take possession of the land allowed to them. And the Israelites served the Lord throughout the lifetime of Joshua and the leaders who outlived him, those who had seen all the great things the Lord had done for Israel. Joshua, son of Nun, the servant of the Lord, died at the age of 110. They buried him in the land he had been allocated at Timnath-Serah in the hill country of Ephraim, north of Mount Gash. After that generation died, another generation grew up who did not acknowledge the Lord or remember the mighty things he had done for Israel. The Israelites did evil in the Lord's sight and served the images of Baal. They abandoned the Lord, the God of their ancestors who had brought them out of Egypt. They went after other gods, worshiping the gods of the people around them, and they angered the Lord. They abandoned the Lord to serve Baal and the image of Ashtaroth. These made the Lord burn with anger against Israel, so he handed them over to the raiders who stole their possessions. He turned them over to their enemies all around, and they were no longer able to resist them. Every time Israel went out to battle, the Lord fought against them, causing them to be defeated, just as he had warned. and the people were in great distress. Then the Lord raised up judges to rescue the Israelites from their attackers. Yet Israel did not listen to the judges, but prostituted themselves by worshiping other gods. How quickly they turned away from the path of their ancestors who had walked in obedience to the Lord's commands. Whenever the Lord raised up a judge over Israel, he was with that judge and rescued the people from the enemies throughout the judge's lifetime. For the Lord took pity on his people who were burdened by oppression and suffering. But when the judge died, the people returned to their corrupt ways, behaving worse than those who had lived before them. They went after other gods, serving and worshiping them, and they refused to give up their evil practices and stubborn ways. May God bless the hearing and reading of God's holy word. Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts, all of our souls, and all of our minds, may they be truly and utterly faithful to your word, O Lord our God, our rock, and our redeemer. And we pray this morning that we would meet you face to face, that you would change our hearts so that we don't repeat the pattern the Israelites have done. Help us to see how we can know the love that you have for us, and that we can love you in that same way. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. When I was growing up, all the sitcoms, the TV shows for kids, all of those little sort of things, always had at least a couple of times a year, they would have a scene where the people, especially like Gilligan's Island or something like that, where they would go into the woods, or they would go into a swamp, or they would go into a forest, and they would walk around, right? And they would walk around for a while, and then after a while, they would come around, and somebody would say, "Haven't we seen that tree before?" No, we haven't seen that tree before. So then they would start walking again, and they'd come back around, and they would say, hey, I think we've seen that tree before. And everybody was, no, let's keep going. And they would start talking about, well, maybe we're lost. Maybe we don't know where we're going. And they'd come around, and they'd come back to the tree, and they'd go, "I've certainly seen that tree before." And then everybody would say, no, we're not lost. We're not. And then they would go off again. And this would happen over and over and over again to see how stubborn people were and how that they couldn't find their way. Well, the Israelites here, over and over and over and over again, the Israelites repeat a stubborn pattern. They're lost. They're alone. They don't, and we're going to see that pattern. So let's look at the story of the judges and see what happens with the Israelites and so that we don't repeat their failure, so that we don't get into the habit of that circle over and over and over again, and that we can be the people who God wants us to be, and we can be the people who aren't lost and who aren't repeating the same mistakes over and over and over again. So we finished the book of Joshua this last week, and there is Joshua at the end. He's standing, he calls all the tribes together. And he stands up in front of all the tribes of Israel, and he says, "You know what? What you cannot do is go after the gods of the people that are around you. We've got to go destroy all these people. We can't give in to following those idols. We can't follow the ways of the people around us." And he says, "You've got to decide today. Today, you've got to decide, are you going to follow the Lord? Are you going to follow the ways of the people around you? Are you going to follow the King of Kings? Are you going to follow after the idols of the people who you're living around?" And the people of Israel, they cry out and they say, "Yes, we're going to serve God." And he says, "No, I don't think you're going to." He says, "You may go after the other gods, but for me and my house, we will serve the Lord." Right? Do you remember that part of the story? And there, after Joshua gives this great sermon where everybody changes their life, they all say, "Yes, I'm going to live for God. I'm not going to follow after the ways of the people around us." All of them say, "Yes, they're going to do that." Their family, their kids, all the people around them, they say, "Yes, our house too is going to serve the Lord." And then Joshua dies. And then that generation of people who said that they were going to follow after God, they die. It says in the book that we just read, and then that generation didn't know God and the deeds that God had done for Israel. I mean, we've learned all about the deeds that God had done for the people of Israel, how he had taken them out of Egypt, how they'd walked across the Red Sea, how they'd wandered in the wilderness, and how God had fed them, how they saw the cloud of fire and the smoke, the cloud of smoke, and God had delivered them throughout all of the different areas, and these people knew God. They knew God in a special way, and it changed their life. And Joshua's generation, they knew God and how he had delivered them across the Jordan River, and how all the battles that God had won for them, and then when they weren't serving God, how they couldn't win the battle, and they knew God, and it changed their life, and they didn't make the mistakes of following the gods around them. But after they died and their parents died, the generation, it says, didn't know God and his acts. And what did they start to do when they stopped knowing God? They started following the ways of the people around them. I mean, that's why God didn't want them going into the land in the first place, because he knew that they would be tempted to follow those idols, to follow the ways of the ones of those around them. And of course, we've gone through the Ten Commandments, and the people of Israel broke those first two laws, right, of the Ten Commandments. Thou shalt have no other gods before me or beside me. And the second one is, you shall not make any graven images of anything in all the earth. And then here they are, these foreign countries that they've come into, the land which is flowing with milk and honey, but it had people there who followed after Baal and Asheroth. These are different gods and goddesses. They had a god for everything, basically, for the harvest, for reproduction, for meat, for the air. They had a god for anything and everything. And the Israelites, instead of worshiping the one true God, started to follow after the idols around them. And so for the next, this whole book of Judges, it's going to be this repeated process. This repeated process where the Israelites have a time of prosperity. They have a time where things are going fantastic and everything's going great because God is with them. They know God. And then when that prosperity comes, they start to follow the gods around them. And then when they start following the gods around them, then God's judgment comes upon them. And they're defeated by their enemies and the people around them. And then when things get really, really, really terribly bad, the Israelite people go, oh, they remembered who God was. And they say, let's cry out to God. And so when they cry out to God, God has grace, and he raises up what they call a judge. Now, a judge here in the book of Judges is not someone who sits and says whether or not you're breaking the law or not. So get that thought of what a judge is out of your mind. For them, it was a regional leader. It was like a king who had each different little area, and they had different places. So they would raise up someone who would lead the people. And they would lead the people out of their sin. And as long as that judge was alive, the people of Israel would follow after God. And they'd stop following the gods around them. And they would start to become the holy people that God wanted them to be. But when the judge died, all over again, they would be prosperous. They would start to follow the gods around them and not follow God's ways. There would be judgment. Things would get terribly bad. And then the people would call out to God, God, save us. And God would send a judge to save them. Now, seven times, there's seven cycles in the book of Judges where God sends a judge to save the people. And after that judge dies, the people are even worse than they were before. And then when that judge dies, the people are even worse than before that judge. And then when that judge dies, the people are even worse before that judge before them, and so on and so on, until the people have gotten so terribly bad. As you read this coming week, you're going to see that the people are really, really bad. And even the judges aren't very good. And we look at these judges and go, how in the world could God use these people who did things that they weren't supposed to do? But God was more concerned with saving the people and delivering them from their sin. And he used those people to bring about change in their life. And these people, when, you know, they would cry out to God every single time. God would raise up a deliverer to save them. You saw the kids go through this morning, waving their palm branches, yelling Hosanna to God in the highest. And Palm Sunday is one of my favorite Sundays of all the year because it brings back memories from when I was a child, waving the palm branches in the service and going and playing swords with my palm branch and hitting my best friend in the back of the head with my palm branch. It brings those great memories back to my mind and how my friend's sister would walk alongside of him and my sister would walk alongside me and carry me throughout as we went around the whole sanctuary and sang Tell Me the Stories of Jesus and waved the palm branches over our heads. And what a joyous time. And for many of us, we don't realize that the word Hosanna that they were yelling, what they're yelling is save us. The Roman Empire had taken over and they had been so oppressed that once again they needed saving. Hold on. Often wheeze and it's just like this story. It's a cycle. And I always send Wesley to go get me water during the service whenever it happens. Well, I haven't had the trouble this year. I do have one in the second service because it does happen over there. But there's probably still dust in here from yesterday, along with all the pollen that went along with it. So the people would cry out, God, save me, as they were oppressed, even though they weren't living their life the way they should, and God would always send a deliverer. Now, this thing about the judge's character, I think one of the reasons why the people never totally changed, the reason why the people's character never totally went to good was because the people that were leading them were sinners too. They didn't have a great character. They didn't have a life that was different. They weren't a holy people like God wanted them to be. And so for them, the cycle just continued and continued and continued until Jesus Christ came. Until Jesus Christ came and they really truly knew the love of God. And you remember that when we talked about the Shema, you remember the Shema, where hear, O Israel, for the Lord our God is one, and that you are to love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, and all your mind, and all your strength. And you remember that was one of the prayers that the Israelites would pray every single day. Twice a day they would pray that prayer. And you remember what their responsibility was to do with that prayer. What was their responsibility? Do you remember? What were they supposed to do? They were to tell it to their children, right? You were to tell it to your children when you're waking up, when you're going to sleep, when you're on your road, when you're going out the door, when you're walking around. The most important thing was you are to tell the children about the love of God. And for the Israelites, the parents weren't telling their children about who God was. They weren't telling them that God was a God that loved them. He wasn't telling them that God was a God that didn't want them to sin. They weren't telling them that God was a God who loved them so much. They weren't telling them that God was a personal God that did all of these miracles for them. They weren't telling the next generation about who God was, and the next generation didn't know who God was. And they didn't know God's love. And that's what caused them to sin. that. But there was, they never, the people, the children didn't know God. And when you don't have a personal relationship with God, when you don't know who God is and how much God loves you, you're going to go into the world and be influenced by the world, and you're going to do what the world tells you to do and not what God tells you to do. You're not going to follow a holy God who loves with all of his heart you. You're going to go and go, well, I'm not going to change my life because I can live the way I want to. And you're going to do just what the Israelites did. But thanks be to God that God sent Jesus Christ into the world to show how much God truly loved us, who sent a deliverer, a savior, a judge to us, who loved us so much that he died on a cross for us, who came into the world and gave up his life, a God who loves us so much that there's nothing he wouldn't do for us. And now that we have that kind of judge, we don't have to get into that cycle. We don't have to get into that way of continually making those mistakes, of falling away from God, of going away from God and following the ways around us, because we know how much God really loves us. And we have a God who is personal and wants to meet us and wants us to be the people who God is calling us to be. Will we be willing to be that people? Will we stand up in front of the world and say, "For as for me and my house, we'll serve the Lord. For me and my house, we love the Lord with all of our heart, soul, mind, body, and strength. So I'm going to live differently than the world around us." I read a little devotion this week and by J.D. Walt. And he told a story of about how his daughter called him this week, that every time during this year, around this time of year, during Easter, for Easter, they always have a tradition where they serve peppermint ice cream pie. And so she called her dad to find out how to bake his grandmother's peppermint ice cream pie recipe for Easter. How many of y'all have little Easter traditions that y'all have every year that y'all make every year that comes from your family? In my family, it's a 47-layer cake. And Addie's pointing out that it's really only four, but it's 47 layers to me. It's about this big. It's different colors, Easter colors. Yeah. At Allison's parents' house, they make Easter bunny cake, a cake in the shape of an Easter bunny, and that's what they do every year. And they pass that on. So now we make the Easter bunny cake for when we're at Allison's family, and my mom still makes the 47-layer cake. My sisters make the 47-layer cake with all of that. And so his daughter had called him, and he realized that he was passing down a fourth-generation recipe, and he was like, how excited he was to know that his daughter was going to be making this for her family for the first time, and how what a great tradition that he had passed on to her, and how exciting it was that this was going to be the fourth generation to make this. And then he realized, you know what? The most important thing that we can really pass down onto our kids is to know a God who loves us. To know a God who loves us so much that forgives us of our sins. To know a God that loves us so much that he died on a cross so that all of those sins could be forgiven. The greatest gift that we could pass down to the next generation is so that they would meet the God face to face that loves them and cares for them and wants them to not live a life of hurt, of sinfulness, and of selfishness, but a life that is filled with love and forgiveness and God's grace upon grace upon grace. God is asking you today, who will you serve? Will you serve the God that is holy, a God who is love, a God whose miracles still happen? Or will you serve the gods that are going on all around in society? As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Let us pray. Gracious and loving Heavenly Father, this morning we come to you to declare that we will serve you. And we want to know you more and more. And we cry out, Hosanna, Lord, save us. Save us from who we are and what we've done. And we thank you that you sent Jesus Christ in the world to deliver us, to be a deliverer, to be our Savior, to be our salvation, and to be someone who is our friend, to know face to face, to see the miracles all around us. And you send your Holy Spirit to empower us so that we don't have to give back into those temptations again. This season of Lent, we've repented of those areas of our life that aren't pleasing to you. Empower us now to overcome those. We pray the blood of Jesus would cover us, and as we journey towards the cross this week, may we nail all of our sins to that cross. May we cry out for our salvation. May we receive that salvation through the blood of Jesus Christ, and may all of those sins be cast away as far as the east is from the west through the sacrifice that your Son Jesus made. It's in Jesus' name we pray.
Good morning, everybody. Welcome to the well. It is now time for joys and concerns. So I'm going to start over here. Anybody has a joy or concern today for us? Yes, ma'am. Been having a lot of trouble with that. Anybody else? Yes, ma'am. Yes. Awesome. Job, Bill. True. Anybody else? Awesome. More than last year, right? You said a little more than last year. Okay. Anybody over here? Yes, sir. Oh, Penny, what's up? Is your birthday today? Thursday? Happy birthday, Penny. Yeah, I'm not going to do a solo up here, so maybe when Winston gets back, he'll... Happy birthday, Penny. So go ahead. Okay. Oh, getting there, so. Anybody else over here? No. All right. Well, let us pray then. Heavenly Father, thank you for time to come together today to fellowship with each other, to learn about your Word, we just thank you for our church family, for our little service. Pray that you would bless our service in the days to come and guide us today. God, we just want to lift up Hillary this week during her surgery, that you would just be with her and her family, and guide the doctors and nurses who work on her. Just give them clarity, and we pray that everything will come out just fine with that. And Lord, we just thank you for all the servants here at the church that helped out with the rummage sale. Thank you for the success we had with that over the years, but especially for the people who always step up and to help to do your work and to raise resources for helping others in our own community here. God, we just pray for Heather Kendrick, too, during this time, going through personal issues. That she'd be with her and be with her family. Just give her comfort right now, Lord, we pray. And God, we just thank you for Penny's life. She celebrates her birthday. Bless her in the years to come as well. And Father, we just ask you to forgive us of our sins. We pray for those who couldn't be here today that for whatever reason, and for anybody who's dealing with personal struggles that you know about, God, we may not know about, but you do know about. So God, we just pray that you would guide us in praying now as Jesus taught us to pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. All right. Now, if y'all would join me in the Apostles' Creed. There we go. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. On the third day, he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Cause we are the chosen generation, rise up, holy nation. God, we live for you. You have called us out of darkness into light so glorious. God, we live for you. Passion for your name will run. Freedom, you've broken every chain, will run. Our God will not be moved. Our God will never be shaken. We'll run to you, we'll run. Cause we are chosen generation, rise up, holy nation. God, we live for you. You have called us out of darkness into light so glorious. God, we live for you. We'll run with passion for your name. We'll run. Freedom, you've broken every chain. We'll run. Our God will not be moved. Our God will never be shaken. We'll run to you. We'll run. Cause we chosen generation, rise up, holy nation. God, we live for you. You have called us out of darkness into light so glorious. God, we live for you. Our God will not be moved. Our God will never be shaken. Our God will not be moved. Our God will never be shaken. Our God will not be moved. Our God will never be shaken. We run to you. We run. Cause we are chosen. Generation, rise up, holy nation. Because we are a chosen generation, rise up, holy nation. God, we live for you, 'cause you have called us out of darkness to light so glorious. God, we live for you. One more time. 'Cause we are a chosen generation, rise up, holy nation. God, we live for you, 'cause you have called us out of darkness into a light so glorious. God, we live for you.
All right, y'all, let's take a couple minutes to greet each other before we get into our connections. I segue you into it, man. So
what key is that one?
Your B flat. My capo 3.
All right, leading right into connections. I like that too, so. Today is the last day to order Easter lilies, $10 each, so place your order. Meetings tonight, 6 o'clock, finance in the conference room and church council at 7 in the fellowship hall. If you have a kid in the Easter musical, they have practice Wednesday at 6 o'clock. The red bags are somewhere back there. Okay, so pick up your red bag. This is what they need. Ramen noodles, canned fruit, sweet peas, and corn. They always need non-fat dry milk and 2 packs of toilet paper, or single packs of toilet paper, too. So they need that all the time. Last month, we collected 460 pounds of food, so thank you all for your support. Holy Week services, Thursday night here at 6, Maundy Thursday. We've been invited to Summer Grove Friday night. I think that one's at 5:30 for Good Friday service, entitled Praying the 7 Last Words of Christ, Friday night at Summer Grove at 5:30. All right, Flowering of the Cross will be next week, Easter Sunday. We may have to wait a few minutes for everybody else to get out there. I'm anticipating that, but we're patient people, so we can do that. That's next Sunday. The following Saturday, April 7th, we'll celebrate James Hill's 40th anniversary with a reception from 2 to 4 on Saturday, and then Sunday he'll be preaching in the combined service. 2 weeks from today, combined service. Everybody remember that. So if you have if somebody wants to submit for a scholarship, you need to turn their name into somebody. Joseph Orban. His number's in here. All right. Also, I want to say, Dulac mission trip is June 24th to 29th. Bill's in charge of that, so see Bill Ward if you want to go. And lastly, there is, I want to thank Dave and Penny. I came up here yesterday. I was going to do the shrubs and stuff, and saw their car, and they were in here. Yeah. In case you wonder how this miraculously gets reset back up, so those two right there.
Everybody give them an applause.
Those two right
yeah.
there,
Woo.
Man. So.
Thank you. Y'all are great.
They spend a lot of time. Penny's up here every week redoing the altar, and we owe y'all gratitude because thank you for doing that.
Even though Penny was catching up with you on your birthday, right?
Yes, and leading it. And since we're speaking about Penny,
we missed our cue earlier. We're gonna sing.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you.
You.
Happy birthday, dear Penny. Happy birthday to you.
All right, they're going to do their last number now, and if anybody wants to come over and pray or talk or join the church or just meditate, I'll be standing right over here, or you can come over here. So with that, turn it over to you guys.
Go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay.
My bad.